Good evening, everyone. There are still chairs in front if anybody wants to move up. If you'd like to move out of the bleacher seats, there are still room in front here. Good evening, everyone. It's a thrill to see you all here this evening. It's a thrill to be part of the first annual AMS President's Endowed Plenary Lecture. As you all know, this event is happening because of the generosity of two wonderful supporters of the AMS, former AMS President Elaine Sisman and her husband, Martin Fridson. We are indebted to them both for the endowment and for the inspired choice of Richard Crawford as the first endowed plenary lecturer. I know Rich needs no introduction, but I have a few minutes of things I'd like to say about him, even so. Richard Crawford has shaped the work of an entire field through the breadth and strength of his research and also the extraordinary gift of his time in reading manuscripts for doctoral students and colleagues in the field. One of the high points of the business meeting for me every year is seeing Rich proudly wave the flag in the form of the latest volumes of MUSA, the series he founded and has led from success to success for an entire generation. The eclecticism of this series is as much a reflection of American music as it is of his own interests. One sees it also in his own research, which ranges from early American psalmody, surely the whitest of white American music, to recent studies of African American music. One sees it as well in the many dissertations he has advised in the last 25 years. Germans have a way of expressing the relationship between a faculty member and a graduate student that is far more poetic than dissertation advisor. The word Doktorvater, which we might translate clumsily as PhD father, grasps the intensity of the relationship, an intensity that Rich Crawford's advisees well know. There are now at least 15 of them. Moreover, Rich has reached an age when his own Doktorkinder have gone forth and begat numerous advisees of their own, so that Rich has truly become a kind of Dr. Großvater. And these children running around must number in the dozens. Indeed, expressions of gratitude to Rich for his help in improving our own writing is ubiquitous. I am one of legions that have benefited from his willingness, I should say eagerness, to help. He was a reviewer for my Porgy and Bess article several years ago, writing me 8 pages of single-spaced suggestions. As a way of testing the scope of his generosity, I Googled, "I would like to thank Richard Crawford and Michigan." There are lots of Richard Crawfords. And this got me 25,000 hits. Googling, "I am grateful to Richard Crawford," brings in another 7,300. One of us in the room thanked him for, quote, "his many acts of kindness to me over the years." Another for "his wise, generous help and support in shaping this book." These are typical. So it is a particular thrill for me that Rich is our first ever endowed plenary lecturer. This is a wonderful way that we as a society can collectively say thank you to this remarkable man. Rich.
If I were asked to write an epitaph for George Gershwin, American composer, six words would do the job. He knew what the situation demanded. In the varied branches of making music, artistic pedigrees matter. And a chronology of musical landmarks, an inventory, you could call it, such as what we've passed out here for you, of things Gershwin accomplished by mid-career, reveals a professional lineage all his own and grounded in boyhood experience. As the 20th century began, Moishe and Rose Gershovitz were Russian immigrants with little education and no musical background, living on the Lower East Side of New York City. When they bought a piano around 1910, they did so with their eldest son, Israel, in mind. But once it was in the house, Jakob, their second son, and an unruly street kid, demanded that he be the one sitting at the piano. And soon after, he demanded to learn more about how it ought to be played. It took Jakob a while to find a piano teacher who recognized his compulsion to make music. As early as age 14, he discovered the concert hall as a place to hear music, and he demanded access to that listening space, too. Still, you should know that Mr. and Mrs. Gershovitz, who had three sons and a daughter, were not the type who doted on their children. Mr. Gershovitz, genial and fond of music, had a knack for starting businesses. But once they turned a profit, his focus at work tended to drift toward playing pinochle with his buddies. His wife, intelligent, demanding, and more or less in charge at home, controlled the family finances. The Gershovitzes had their economic ups and downs, but Rose's daughter recalled that her mother was never without a maid, and her offspring were left pretty much to their own devices. The circa 1913 date on your chronology marks two related phenomena. In an article published years later, Gershwin wrote that his musical facility owed much to a habit that he had consciously cultivated, and now I'm quoting, since I was in my early teens, my habit of intensive listening, linked to piano playing. My habit of intensive listening. I had gone to concerts and listened not only with my ears, but with my nerves, my mind, my heart. I had listened so earnestly that I became saturated with the music. Then I went home and listened in memory. I sat at the piano and repeated the motives, end quote. As he discovered his own approach to listening, which was linked to piano playing, the youngster also explored a popular style grounded in syncopated rhythm. Since the turn of the century, the dance-based music called ragtime had blossomed, both in instrumental settings and in songs. Once in a while, too, its essential rhythmic mannerism was applied to familiar classical works, as in Ragging the Traumerei, which Gershovitz composed in 1913 by decorating Robert Schumann's famous piano piece with syncopated turns. Maybe that effort was on Charles Hambitzer's mind when he recalled his students' fondness for embellishing and decorating classical numbers, a practice that the teacher refused to discourage. In 1914, after he finished the ninth grade, Jakob Gershovitz turned pro. Leaving school at age 15, he went to work for a Tin Pan Alley publisher, as a song plugger, an accompanist charged with selling his company's songs to singers in search of new material. In 1916, he published his first popular song and his first show song. And the music in both is attributed to George Gershwin. The name change sticks, and from then on, the family adopts it too. In 1917, he quits that job for one as an accompanist of another kind. Having learned that musical theater's so-called production music for Broadway shows with scores is what he most wants to write, he signs on as a rehearsal pianist for a Broadway show with a score by Victor Herbert and Jerome Kern. In 1918, still a teenager, he lands as good a job as an American songwriter can hold. Starting that winter, T.B. Harms Incorporated, the number one American publisher of show music, hires him as a staff composer for $35 a week, plus royalties on songs or compositions that the firm agrees to print. From here on in the chronology, you'll be seeing the names of some of his shows and some of the lyricists that he works with, chiefly his brother Israel, later Ira Gershwin, a man with a talent for light verse, who eventually joins the song-making trade and writes words for his younger brother's melodies. Now, the tentative chronology for 1918 and 19 points to matters whose precise dates are not known. The first one indicates Gershwin's discovery of blues songs, a musical species then reaching Tin Pan Alley from oral tradition in the American South. The second marks a new phase of his self-directed education. He starts regular lessons in harmony with Edward Coligny, a European trade composer and conductor. Blues music steers Gershwin toward a kind of popular song that engages with life's troubles and defeats, while deepening his link to African-American music and broadening his tonal idiom. The harmony lessons enrich a technical framework that prepares him to compose on a scale larger than songwriting. Peeking ahead to around 1923 for a moment, we see on the chronology Gershwin hiring Reuben Goldmark, a composer and teacher of composition, whose advice in later years is supplanted by other teachers, including Henry Cowell, Wallingford Rieger, and Joseph Schillinger. Now, please note 1922 and Gershwin's third score for Broadway producer George White's annual review, reviews being variety shows rather than musical comedies with characters and plots. The headline act of that show was a dance ensemble, Paul Whiteman and his orchestra, which also played nightly in the ballroom of a leading New York cafe and made recordings for the Victor label. The classically trained Whiteman was among the day's top entrepreneurs of popular music. Working on Broadway with Gershwin, Whiteman spotted a unique talent and a future collaborator. A last-minute addition to George White's Scandals of 1922 was a 25-minute opera a la Afro-American called Blue Monday, built around a fatal shooting in Harlem and played in blackface by members of the Scandals all-white cast. During the review's tryout run in New Haven, Connecticut, the operatic sketch drew critical praise. But when the Scandals reached Broadway, the producer, deciding that Blue Monday was too long and too alien to the rest of the show, cut it after just one performance, a decision that Gershwin is said to have taken hard. extending his reach overseas by composing a review for London early in 1923, Gershwin returned to New York, where, in the fall, he performed for the first time on a concert stage. Mezzo-soprano Ava Gautier offered a recital in Aeolian Hall featuring ancient and modern songs from Europe and the United States. Devoting the American portion to numbers by the likes of Jerome Kern, Irving Berlin, and Gershwin himself, she hired Gershwin to help her choose the songs, which in fact contained Alexander's Ragtime Band, and then to accompany her singing of them in his idiomatic way. Gautier's recital invited the audience to compare, on the basis of craftsmanship and appeal, these American songs with the rest of her repertoire, which included songs by Hindemith, Schoenberg, Bartok, Mio, as well as Purcell and Bellini. The recital also gave New York's music critics their first chance to judge work by Gershwin and his songwriting compatriots, and to hear the spontaneous vigor of his accompaniments. 3 months later, in the same hall, a concert by the Paul Whiteman Orchestra offered a historic opportunity, and Gershwin made the most of it. Labeling the program an experiment in modern music, Whiteman aimed to prove that his group's jazz-oriented arrangements and style of playing could reward listeners in a concert hall setting. He also invited the music critics to public rehearsals, and he advertised a new concert work for piano and orchestra by Gershwin. Orchestrated by Ferdy Groffet and conducted by Whiteman, the Rhapsody in Blue featured the composer as piano soloist. Combining rhythmic flexibility and freedom, technical virtuosity, and jazz-based sounds and tunes, Gershwin's Rhapsody delighted the audience. The critics showed up too. Many reckoned the originality of his approach, and a few heard the new piece as an example of genuinely modern music in an American style. Sure that he had a winner on his hands, Whiteman featured the Rhapsody in a spring tour with Gershwin as soloist. He also recorded it with the composer, and he made the new composition, his theme song. Gershwin's year 1924 ended with a musical comedy produced, created, and performed by young men and women of the jazz age generation. A show about flappers and their swains at play, celebrating the carefree idiom of their lives and loves with a fresh kind of dancing, singing, and banter. Starring the brother and sister, Fred and Adele Astaire, and with new songs by the new team of George and Ira Gershwin, Lady Be Good ran on Broadway for more than 300 performances, followed by Road Company Travels, and 2 years later, a long run with the Astaires in London. By 1925, Gershwin's ideas about what his situation demanded had made him a singular presence. A top American songwriter who was not only an accomplished pianist, but a composer too. Please note on the chronology that year's four premieres for the stage. Two song and dance musicals in the vein of Lady Be Good, half the score of a Russian operetta, and Paul Whiteman's attempt to revive the 1922 Blue Monday in a new orchestration by Groffet. But then, at the end of the year, and surely beyond the realm of business as usual, appeared the three-movement Concerto in F for piano and orchestra, commissioned by Walter Damrosch and the New York Symphony Orchestra, and premiered in Carnegie Hall with the composer as soloist. Yet beyond these milestones, there are other indications that help to reveal 1925 as a tipping point in the public's understanding of George Gershwin and his music. First, the number of his personal interviews published that year jumped from one or two to almost a dozen. Second, on July 20th, his picture appeared on the cover of Time magazine, the first American-born musician to be so honored. The next one, by the way, was 1934. For a third example, please turn to the last page of your handout. Just flip it around. This glimpse of the landscape from the October issue of Vanity Fair magazine features seven cartoon images of prodigious figures in the world of music. Six male Europeans are pictured, including a patron, two violinists, two conductors, and a bespectacled composer who seems to be on high alert watching the back of musical objectivity. The seventh figure is George Gershwin from New York's Lower East Side. And what makes him prodigious? The blurb under his picture is simply playful. But the scope of the musical situations that he has mastered has enabled him, at age 27, to win an audience of unprecedented size and scope. Challenging the well-known territorial divide in America's musical life, the boundary alleged to separate classical music and art from popular music and entertainment, he now merits the identity that Irving Berlin would claim for him when he called Gershwin the only songwriter I know who turned into a composer. Now we're closing in on the turning point of this talk, the year 1926, when Gershwin chose the subject of the opera he hoped someday to compose. In the fall of 1924, Otto Kahn, chairman of the Metropolitan Opera Board, had made known in a newspaper article his hope of commissioning a jazz opera by an American composer. Gershwin had responded with interest, and the subject sparked several articles during the winter and spring that followed. In April 1925, the journal Musical America carried its own story about the subject, explaining Gershwin's view that the Met could not stage a jazz opera because it lacked the core of African-American singers that such a project would demand. A jazz opera, Gershwin thought, ought to take the shape of an opera comique performed six nights a week on Broadway, plus a Saturday matinee. When in the fall of 1926 he happened upon Hayward's novel, Porgy, set in a mythical neighborhood of Charleston, South Carolina, called Catfish Row, he found the story he'd been looking for. When a letter introducing himself to Hayward drew a positive response, the two men met and agreed to collaborate on a Porgy opera. But not yet, for in 1926, Gershwin knew very well that he faced another demand. He lacked the knowledge and technique that composing a full-length opera about a black community in the American South would require. By the time a contract for an opera based on Porgy was signed in 1933, the novel, reworked by Hayward and his playwright wife, Dorothy, had long since won acclaim as a Broadway play. On the composer's side, schooled by more study and a lot more experience writing for orchestra, Gershwin felt ready to take up the life of an opera composer. Thus, Hayward, still living in the South, made a libretto out of his play and sent it in installments to Gershwin in New York. His script included texts that he'd written for sacred songs in the spiritual vein. Lyrics for Gershwin to set to music for a chorus of several dozen, for the opera, after all, is about individuals in a large community. And that brings us to Mr. Gershwin's Catfish Row spirituals. One way African slaves in America pushed back against slavery was to create songs that enabled them to worship a Christian God in their own vernacular. Such spirituals, admired beyond the community in which they originated, and collected from oral tradition, came to be written down and circulated in varied arrangements as a unique American musical genre. For the play Porgy in 1927, the Haywards had chosen a number of these songs, and director Ruben Mamoulian had staged their performance with beauty and dramatic effect. Once an opera contract was signed, Gershwin paid his first visits to the region, as Hayward had long urged him to do. But what especially caught his attention there, rather than spiritual songs, were varieties of singing that were new to his ears. He heard commercial street cries, for example, from peddlers of strawberries or devil crabs, hawking their wares on the neighborhood streets. Also, visiting a rural house of worship with Hayward, he heard a black community congregation raise its voices in a babble of simultaneous prayers. Here is the collective prayer that Gershwin composed for the end of Act Two. Six different vocal lines sung at the same time over a choral drone, while the orchestra represents the hurricane that is raging outside. So this is example number one. The examples are in there on page four. Example, Oh Dr. Jesus. And this, by the way, is from a Sony recording conducted by Nicholas Harnoncourt. I hope I can get the right. just. Dr. Jesus, obviously no spiritual, is Gershwin's facsimile of an oral survival from the region's deep past, as are the street cries he also included in the opera. But such moments are rare in Porgy and Bess. Indeed, after the production opened in Broadway in October 1935, an article Gershwin wrote for the New York Times, he called it Rhapsody in Catfish Row, declared Porgy and Bess a folk tale. And he added that his idea of folk expression stems not from the origins of the material, but from its character and its style. The opera's characters, being of the folk themselves, he wrote, naturally would sing folk music. Then came this remarkable pair of sentences. Quote, "When I first began work on the music, I decided against the use of original folk material because I wanted the music to be all of one piece. Therefore, I wrote my own spirituals and folk songs." In other words, borrowed spirituals would need to be arranged to fit with Gershwin's own music. But the operatic score that he had written depended entirely on his own craft as a composer. By my reckoning, Porgy and Bess includes two folk songs, Summertime and A Woman is a Sometime Thing, and seven spirituals, the latter listed on page 4 of the handout, as I already directed you to. The folk songs are off the table for this talk because they're secular, and a spiritual is sacred. I'm defining it here as a sacred choral song or composition, which in Porgy and Bess covers a wide range of styles and approaches. The label sacred choral composition fits the first two examples. Gone, 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 which begins Act 2, Scene 1, and We're Leaving for the Promised Land, which closes that scene. Rather than being tune-based, both of these numbers are built around statements and restatements of material that is distinctive but not songful. As for the choral songs, they include It Take a Long Pull to Get There, Oh, the Lord Shake the Heavens, Oh, There's Somebody Knocking at My Door, Clara, and Oh, Lord, I'm on My Way. Each of these songs is based on a Gershwin melody and a full-fledged tune with its own character. The opera's second scene opens with the people of Catfish Row mourning a tragedy. In the first scene, an amiable neighbor by the name of Robbins is killed during a crap game in a drunken fight with Crown, a mighty stevedore. In scene 2, a call and response interchange between soloists and chorus leads off an extended, diverse, 14-minute musical flow, mourning the death of Robbins, now gone from Catfish Row. Sometimes, repeated in quarter notes, Gone is sung in a way that emulates the tread of a funeral march. But sometimes, too, Gone is drawn out in legato lines sung over a descending bass. Recurring through most of the scene, the two kinds of gone material reflect a community shocked, almost overcome by grief. And here's the opening call and response. This is example number 2, and this comes from an EMI recording conducted by Simon Rattle.
He's a gone, gone, gone.
Will the dead man's widow find the money to bury him? Or will the authorities seize his corpse for the use of medical students? The outcome depends on how the people of Catfish Row contribute to Robbins's burial saucer, resting on the chest of his corpse. And their mood rises and falls as the widow tallies the proceeds meant to send him to heaven with his body and his soul intact. When finally an undertaker with a big heart agrees to provide a proper burial, the people rejoice in a triumphant choral number. Now they imagine the dead man's soul on a journey to the promised land. Like a railway conductor, a lead singer gives the all aboard call. And once the train hits running speed, the people turn into a disciplined choral ensemble, singing, "Oh, we're leaving for the promised land, etc." At one point in three-part counterpoint, with each vocal line at a different speed. Blending classical technique with Broadway razzmatazz, Gershwin invents a striking way for musically sophisticated neighbors to honor a compatriot who is gone, and to close a solemn first act with a joyful finale. We're leaving for the promised land, and this again is from the EMI recording by Rattle. Starts very softly. Scene one brings a reminder that the men of Catfish Row work hard for a living, many of them as stevedores on the docks and fishermen on the sea. The enterprising, pious Jake, husband of Clara, who earlier has sung the lullaby Summertime to their new baby boy, is captain of the Seagull, a fishing boat. The fall storm season is almost upon them, but he and his crew are loading their nets for tomorrow's final trip to the Blackfish Banks off Charleston Harbor. In the song about the labor ahead of them, Jake sings a narrative in three stanzas, each followed by the crew's refrain, which ends with a reference to the promised land, punctuated with a work song vocable. He'd take a long call to get there. In the last scene of Act Two, the people of Catfish Row, huddling to escape the hurricane that has roared in off the sea, sing about what they have witnessed. In "Oh, the Lord, Shake the Heavens," they respond to the storm's force with wonder. Many believe they're watching the scriptural prophecy of Judgment Day. the time when Jesus returns from heaven to earth to judge the fate of every mortal soul, whether to spend eternity in heaven or face perpetual torment in the fires of hell. Hence such forebodings in the refrain as, "Oh, de sun gone arise to the west." Sorry. "Oh, the sun gone to rise in the west, and the moon gonna set in the sea." Again, the form is strophic, with an 8-bar verse in 2 stanzas, each followed by a refrain. Gathered indoors to ride out the tempest, the people in this scene are locked into a cycle of singing and prayer. Begging for the mercy of God, the singers repeat both verse and refrain melodies long enough, often enough, to add continuity to a long stretch of music. Yet Gershwin also furthers the drama by using later stanzas as background for more dialogue among the characters. During the first repeat of the verse, for example, Porgy tries to reassure Clara, whose fears mount as Jake and his crew fail to return from their journey. And in the refrain that follows, Robbins's widow Serena and the drug peddler Sporting Life disagree on what's causing the storm. Her faith in biblical prophecy imagines graves opening as the dead emerge to face final judgment. He, on the other hand, reminds her that in Catfish Row, after all, we have had storms before. Here's example number 4. This is the Harnoncourt recording. Mindful that this scene involves a stage full of people waiting out a hurricane, Gershwin also maintains variety and flow by adding other material between his musical restatements. At one point, Clara reprises a stanza of Summertime her lullaby in scene one. And from time to time, too, sweeping sounds in the orchestra signify bursts of wind, lightning, and thunder from the storm, silencing the singers, at least intermittently. The opera's next spiritual lends a jolt of surprise by interrupting the song about Judgment Day. After another stormy blast, a pounding at the door heightens the fear in the room. The notion that somebody's out in this weather distracts the people from their fear of heavenly judgment, prompting a simple, jaunty, 15-bar refrain in AABA form. Oh, there's somebody knocking at the door. There is somebody knocking at the door. It repeated twice in as the source of that sound is being debated. When the door is forced open, a familiar but long-absent character muscles his way in. It's Crown, the ex-lover of Bess, whom he now sees in the room sitting with Porgy. Since killing Robbins in the first scene, Crown has been a fugitive, hiding out on an island in Charleston Bay. Now suddenly back in Catfish Row, he claims to have survived a fight with God himself, who, he says, unleashed the storm's full force upon his own hideout. Outlasting that attack, Crown now beholds his former neighbors with disdain for their spineless huddling and pleas to be spared from the tempest that he himself claims to have battled to a draw. In the scene's waiting moments, Clara, catching a glimpse of the turmoil, sees a capsized fishing boat float by. It's Jake's boat, the seagull. When she rushes out into the storm, Crown follows, hoping to save her from drowning. Act two ends with the rest of the company delivering the collective prayer to Dr. Jesus, which we heard as example one. The last two spirituals are sung in act three. In about 40 bars of cut time, O Lord, I'm on my way, the shortest opera finale I know, and a dense one too, pulls together a multitude of dramatic musical threads from themes to leitmotifs. But instead of hearing a recorded finale less than 90 seconds long, whose impact depends on the context, let's instead turn to the second last spiritual in Porgy and Bess. When the invitation to give this talk arrived, it occurred to me, as a biographer of George Gershwin, that the people in this room, musicians, scholars, music lovers, might enjoy a taste of music making ourselves. An experience of the kind that got us into this business in the first place, after all. And a chance to sing some Gershwin music ourselves, together. The music on the handout's last two pages, preceded in the opera by a long, quiet, orchestral introduction, is for the spiritual Clara, which opens Act Three. It's not a famous composition, nor is it a long one, but maybe singing it, getting it into our voices and our ears, will offer another way to remind ourselves what this particular situation demanded of Gershwin, the composer, and how he responded. It's the night after the hurricane, and residents of Catfish Row have drowned in the storm, including Jake, his crew, and his wife Clara, who, when she saw the seagull overturned, raced outside in hope of finding her man. In this spiritual, the singers address the souls of their departed friends and neighbors, assuring them that they won't be forgotten. The words the people sing here were composed by DeBose Hayward. Yet two decades after George Gershwin's career, the creation of the music was on the mind of his brother and collaborator, Ira, as he finished an anthology of his own song texts, lyrics on several occasions, which was published in 1959. In that book's penultimate paragraph, as if finally facing the long avoided, the long avoided task of describing his brother's genius. Ira, I should mention to you, was extremely, he knew nothing technically about music. He was a very musical person, but he knew nothing about technique. And any time he was asked to say anything about music in print, he became extremely cautious. But it's on the almost the last page of his book, and has decided that he somehow has to take on this issue of his brother's genius after working at his side. So he starts to explain, but ends up having to settle for just one sentence. "These many years," he begins, but then he breaks off, and after an ellipsis, he admits, "I can still shake my head in wonder at the reservoir of musical inventiveness, resourcefulness, and craftsmanship George could dip into." Yes, the right word from the wordsmith Ira, as you might expect. Talking about the reservoir of bounty that George Gershwin brought to composition. Now, since you're going to be singing the music for Clara, there's no need for me to say more about the music, but we do need to agree on an approach. I'm not recruiting soloists, don't worry. In the role of rehearsal pianist and then of orchestra imitator, I'm pleased to have the help of Professor Jason Geary from the Musicology Department, University of Michigan School. And I propose that we all start by singing the melody in the first stanza, the top stanza, staff, in whatever octave you find comfortable, if any. And feel free to change octaves if you like. Then, let's sing Gershwin's six-part harmonization, each in our own vocal range, with orchestra accompaniment by the professor. And there is, I'll tell you just one thing. I want to declare a tenor alert. It's on page 4, and it's I don't know how many people. I see Rufus out there. He's ready to go on that one. I thought maybe it would be a good idea to try the tenors on that part because it goes all the way up to a leading tone, and it sounds like it's going to pull down to a dominant, but it doesn't, and it ends up on the A. Anyway, just warn you, I don't expect you to read it well, but it doesn't matter. It's okay. All right. So, Shall we sing the first, let's sing a unison stanza. Now, I can say, after the unison stanza, we can go back and sing our six-part harmonization, which would be Clara, Clara, and so forth. Then, we can do a second verse just by changing Clara to Jake. So, Jake, Jake. So, Gershwin was a composer who loved when he repeated anything to change it. It's all varying things. I think this is one of those pieces where he said, you know, it's perfect the first time. I'm going to repeat it note for note. But that's just me talking. That's not an official word based on documentation. Anyway, let's start out with the melody. To the next picking. Clara. Canceling the morning rehearsal. It's all right. Thank you very much.
any society can do a plenary lecture, but what other society can do what we just did here tonight? I have something I'd like to give both Rich and Elaine, so this will take about 30 seconds. Meeting adjourned. And the reception is just beginning.